Let's take a back chat.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Dad.
Oh, my goodness.
I feel like I'm at 25.
I know, huh?
Well, all I gotta say is...
That was good.
You just did a great job.
What I like to do with this, because I think that it's just really, really helpful, because we learn from all the wonderful things that, you know, were done so beautifully, and we learn from things that maybe weren't done, and maybe something that might have been done differently. That may or may not be the case here, but what I like to do is I like to go around, but I have to tell you that we need to finish this in 15 minutes. I want us to get in the habit of that, because otherwise we could be here for 3 hours. There's many, many things that we can discuss. What I'd like to do, to begin with, is I'd like us to go from person to person. You do not have to say something. If you have something to say that's different from what someone else says, then please share what it was that you thought, one thing, and I'm sure there were 10 things or 20, but one thing that really touched you the most, that you thought was just made this a really wonderful infant baptism experience, okay? And if you agree with what somebody else said, you can say, I agree with what Martha said, and we'll go on that, okay? That's just in the interest of not repeating. And then after that, then we'll talk about things that we can find in your partner that we'd like to suggest, okay? So if that's clear to everybody, and I like to just kind of go around the room, and it would be different every time, so Mike, why don't you begin?
Great job. Set the standard very high for the rest of us.
Yeah, I want you to say something, a specific thing he did that you really appreciate.
I enjoyed that, the epitha, because I had not, at the baptisms I've seen and been to, I had heard that.
It's optional.
That was special.
I've never seen it.
Frank had expressed that he thought it was something really important, and then maybe he did it so beautifully.
Yes, he did. I agree with
that. Thank you, Mike. Martha?
I agree with that.
Joe? You look very diaconal. I mean, I know that's a God-given, you know, but you presented yourself as being very diaconal. I don't know how else to put that.
That means we're all almost ready.
So the diaconal presence, the way he carried his body, the way he wore his out, the way he moved, all of that.
I enjoyed your homily. I thought it was nice and succinct and to the point, and I got a message from it about the garment, using the prop of the garments. Spoke to me.
First time I heard the thing, that verse or that phrase, I can't remember which part is in the book. But when you sang that verse, it's the first time I've heard it in
The affirmation?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And you see how simple that was? Mm-hmm. Just stay on.
I would never even thought of doing that until you mentioned that it is sung sometimes. So.
Mm-hmm. All the difference in the world.
Beautiful. I think the celebration is beautiful. Again, as I've never experienced or seen a baptism that has music that makes me so alive. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So thank you for thanks to the choir. Mm-hmm. Larry?
Demeanor.
Yep.
Carried it.
Leadership, needed.
Yes.
It pulls everything together, and everybody feels drawn to it, and so begin to respond to it even naturally, even if he doesn't say anything. The body language invites you to do what needs to be done.
Being a very large church and very strong word, and being here and there, we appreciate the pronunciation, the enunciation, how loud you were in the back and up here, but it's clear that you get across there.
First of all, before praying, I think the assembly was excellent. And that's what it means to be full and active, good participant. And it was beautiful. It's like we only need to do once. It's like so beautiful. And I think his voice, when you especially read the gospel, your eye one thing, and you have to speak with me, because so, like, I could feel the Holy Spirit from all your entire presence in your voice. It was very, very nice.
It seems that Frank already ordained.
Just already been
ordained.
Last year when I was doing communal vigil or something like that, his one comment about my performance was that I had streamers all over the place.
Yes.
Will there be enough to do the critique as well?
Right. Okay.
I like the whole atmosphere of singing. I did like too. I think the way you were playing with the water made it more real. When you were blessing the water, you know, when you're allowing the water to be water.
It tells you to do that.
And you know that the suggestion that Rick Soria has is that you use a shell, because you can get even more water. You can be even more generous. Yeah. Don't be afraid that.
And here's something to keep in mind: using the shell, you have a wet hand when you're done with that, and you go back to your book or whatever you're going back to. So the shell might keep your hand a little dry.
And it also helps that you may choose at some point to really work with a young acolyte or a young server at your parish and always have someone holding your book, so that things like oil and water don't get in the way, and then you can do whatever you want. Thank you.
I like the intonation of the Litany of the Saints, and also including the name of the child in there.
The name of his parish, you can include the name of the grandparents, depends on how much time you have.
Everything is excellent. The your gestures, the tune of your voice, I really like it. It's so clear and it's easy to understand your problem. Very nice.
It is well prepared, well done. The only thing I noticed is the book. The ribbon is hanging.
Still hanging.
I think we should be gems.
Well? Mm-hmm. It's a small thing, but isn't it interesting? It's something that can be distracting to people. Small, small distraction, but it can make a difference, can't it? Okay? All right. I have to tell you, I've never heard anybody use a homily quite that way. I mean, I thought and you see, here's a good example of how you can take anything from the right, connect it with the scripture, and speak about it. And so what he did is choose this beautiful symbol of the owl, which you know we should all be wearing. Every single one of us who are baptized, that's what we should wear on Sunday. Save our families a lot of money, because we just have one of you wear it over and over and over again. That owl, and then to use all of that beautiful language and talking about what it means to be clothed in Christ. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful idea. Did you have something you wanted to say, Ray?
I agree with everyone.
Okay, so let's start at the back here with Remy, and let's talk about some suggestions you have. How something you saw that something might have been different. You look the same way.
Okay, the homily. Mm-hmm. I prefer that he gets closer to the people.
Right.
Especially. Because it is so far, mm-hmm. especially if there are, you know, Catholic, non-Catholic, it's like it's personal, and he gets closer.
Okay. Now, you know you could actually have preached from your chair.
Oh, yes, and this is a perfect thing. I would love to have been walking around doing this and knowing what to say, but I didn't have that script down, and I tried to, I developed that thing as a sign, and it seems very simple that I should have been able to pick these words out of my brain without having to have a cheat sheet. But I didn't quite get it done, and I didn't want to stumble over words and not make sense.
Okay, just so you know, this is perfectly okay. Come down to your chair so you can be closer to the people. Mm-hmm. Put your homily on that, keep it off to the side, because you had most of it memorized. Yeah. So that you can glance at it. But you can still talk to people and be closer. Just know you can do that. You can always preach from the chair. Okay? Good suggestion. See, small thing. What he did was great, but we can make it even better. Mm-hmm. How about you, Viola?
I think the voice is perfect. The voice is perfect for me. I think a little bit more faster because it's very small for me.
Okay, now, did everybody hear what she said? That she felt like she felt like it was a little bit slow, like it could have been faster. Now, let's ask Jan how she felt about that. Okay. See, I think it's really good to hear this, because what you find out is that, and if you were to go around, everybody might have a little bit of a different feel for it. So I think probably I would err, that's in quotation marks, on the side of slower, because there's younger children, there are elderly grandparents who might be hard of hearing, there may be other people who are hard of hearing, and so to be sensitive to that, and you kind of have to draw the balance. You have to draw the balance. And the thing that you need to do if you're a survivor is look around when you're talking. That's why you don't want to get stuck in the book, because the rhythm that you use to speak with people, you'll get a sense of whether or not you're engaging people. Yes.
Well, and the acoustics as well.
Absolutely. All those things you'll find out, in terms of your own parish. But it's so important that gets brought up. Thank you for bringing it up. How about you, Rick?
Well, the proclamation of the gospel, he made a sign of the cross on the book of the gospel itself, but not on himself.
Okay. All right, and here's one of the other things that's really important. That's why there's a lot of things about the rite itself that you need to fix. Like, for example, you need to say, let us pray, instead of just starting the prayers. It connects. You didn't always. There were times when you just started in the prayer. But you do, because that's what's in the book. The book, all the critiques of that rite, critique that fact that it doesn't do that. Now, the reason I bring it up in this context, ritual needs to be the same. People are used to waiting for those cues, at least the people who have been before. So we need to say things like, let us pray, and give people the opportunity to focus and then begin the prayer. It's why those endings, we ask this in Jesus' name, they're not there at the end of all those prayers. You must add them, because otherwise it's hanging there. You say what you have to say, and people don't quite, so you look at them and then you say, amen. But does it feel quite right, does it?
No, it doesn't.
It does not feel quite right, because this is the powerful and the challenge of ritual. It needs to be what people expect. Okay, so remember that the next time.
The hallelujah after the trial of baptism, it would sound better if it was more of a beat, like calling out and something like that a little quicker, because it's so good.
Yes, I agree with you. My tendency during Advent is to do it a little bit lower key because of the season. But normally, yes, you would. You would do something that's full of life. You might even do the Celtic Hallelujah because it's longer and it's elongated. I chose to do something that was a little bit more low key because of Advent, but normally it would be. Yes, it should be full of, I agree. And in fact, it can be something else. It doesn't have to be Hallelujah. Rex the Christus, hallelujah, could be, or something like that that's really expanding. So we can work on that when we look at some of the possibilities for music. Yes, that's a good one too. And actually, you know what I saw happen once?
I'd be so afraid if it would actually happen.
But it's happened in real baptism. The people sang that, and they all got up, because they were all kind of going just like, they all got up and they circled the family, holding hands, just singing, and they sang over and over again. It was so amazing. Yeah. Now let me tell you, that family will never forget that baptism. That baby even felt it. I mean,
she's smiling.
Yeah, she's laughing. She's smiling the whole thing. So thank you for that. That you're right. That
baby. By the way, the expression on that child did change.
In the water.
Francisco, how about you?
Yes, in my case, it's perfect, but just only in my case, when you read the This one.
What do you call this?
The right book? The right
book? Yes, slowly, and, take time. In my case.
Yeah. See? The difference in a sense of what it was.
I don't have any suggestion to improve, but I have a question on the, before I started for intercession, isn't it the celebrant should start, my yes. dear brothers and sisters?
My moment of silence was interrupted. I'm sorry.
Yeah. let me just tell you, there's a couple of things here that you want to remember, and that is that the rite doesn't tell you when people should stand or sit. So what you do is you go to the primary liturgy, which is the Mass, and what's the posture for the intercession?
Standing.
And we always stand up before it even begins. Mm-hmm. So now somebody who's diaconal, you have to develop a natural sense of what those are, because most of the time, you're going to be telling the people to stand or sit. So if you don't put it in your worship aid, and it wasn't in the worship aid, which is okay, I like to put it in the worship aid, because then it's there if I forget, because sometimes you do forget when you're writing. Then he needs to tell people when to stand. Okay?
I did once I stood up.
Yeah, you did. You did, which was fine. That's right. And of course, I stood up because I was in the very back just trying to get a little cue, but nobody was taking it. So I thought, well, maybe they have something else in mind, so I better sit down and wait.
But what's more important, we all should be well versed in knowing that the moment of silence does not become corrupted.
I don't think you can ever assume that. I think you have to, that has to all be part, I would even put it in a worship aid.
But see, even I hear things said that was for the celebrant to say.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You decided to say it.
Well, I did because I thought that you forgot.
Yeah. And let me just say this. One of the other things that I did you see what he did? Did anybody else notice
what he
added about halfway through? What did he add?
We pray.
Yeah.
Yes. Again, it doesn't happen in the rite. But we needed it.
Yeah.
We need something, because otherwise it's like, well, is it done? Is it not done?
Yeah.
See, and he just did that naturally, so that was great. Now, many people who ask for the intercessions are going to do it naturally because they won't know. They won't have enough nerve to do it. Okay? Jan.
And this is, I think he handled himself very well with oil and water and trying to wipe his hands off and keep everything flowing. Mm-hmm. But I don't think there's a natural sense of that.
Well, this is for this space, this is what you do.
Yeah, now the thing is what you're going to find is that those of you who are couples, you will probably have your wife be your assistant. Now, you don't have to be, she doesn't have to be. Somebody else could be actually in the group, one of the other guys, because you could use servers in your parish or whatever, and so they'd be carrying things and handing things, and you'll get into a rhythm with the person that you're used to doing it with. But you're gonna learn from what he did. Okay, now how can I make that smoother? He's really just basically set kind of he's put out something that we can all learn from and move forward with. I mean, what a guy to do it, because it's very intimidating, isn't it?
Yeah. And what was here and what wasn't here that you bought? I was just curious. I know.
Yeah. Now you notice that we focus basically on the Word, because this is basically a liturgy of the Word. But we lit the candles, because it's Advent, don't ignore what's going on in the church. And he, because he chose to do the ritual at the end that I'm so glad that you chose to do. Now, was that not a powerful picture? To see him standing behind there with the parents and the godparents and the baby. I wish you could have seen it. Well, you'll see it because you'll see the pictures. A powerful picture and a powerful liturgical catechesis. About that being the ultimate goal there. You lose that if you don't do that. Mm-hmm. So the fact that the altar was decorated and that the candles were lit and they weren't ignored. The only thing that might be different in a parish is ordinarily I'm not happy for having a font up in the front like this. It works here though, with this small group of people, because you're all right here. If you're going to be, if you don't have a font that's built in, it's nice to be able, if you have something like this, to put it someplace that where you can come up in stations. And if everybody would start at the door. And we would all process up together, we'd sit in the pews, halfway up. you know, and the fault would be in the middle. There was room there. Frank was wise. He said, I don't want people crowding around it. It'll be hard for the parents and the godparents to do the ritual around it that's in the narrow aisle. It's one thing if you have to just walk by, it's a whole other thing when you're doing ritual, right? And then when we finish there, we could have focused on, somebody still could have come up and used, or they could have done the work down there. That would have been okay. But they could have come up here and done it as well. Maybe you'd even have the font be two-thirds of the way up, but still in the aisle. So we all come up here and sit for the liturgy of the word, and then, you know, we go back and stand around the font for the baptisms, and then at the end we process up to the altar and we can all do that together. That's one way of doing it, okay? I think Frank really chose well, because it was the first time he did it. He took everything into consideration and made good choices about moving things the way he did. He decorated this, it's seasonal. It's really important to decorate the animal, especially when it's that ugly. Mm-hmm. Because it's just not a lovely piece, so at least you give it some color. You saw he had a table for his stuff. Now that I see the table up there, I think I might have chosen something smaller. It's almost as big as the chair. And then he, of course, had the pastel candle.
So all the tables were here.
For me?
He had the cloth and the oil and the towel.
Yeah. Brought his own oils. And you can all decide who's doing this next. By the way, I found the paper.
Ray.
You're at the end.
Ray.
Oh, wow.
Okay. All right, if that's the case, if Ray and Remy are next, then what I suggest you do is you get together with Frank. And each person's going to teach the next person where everything is in here. So now he knows where all the stuff is in there, what's available here. So you'll work with him and to find out where all the stuff was. He'll tell you what he brought from home and what he didn't, if he's willing to let everybody use the oils. If you decide this is going to be the class baby, I don't see how. And because most of the stuff they already have. They have this cloth, they have other colors of cloth as well. You just have to put everything back exactly where you found it and fold it nicely. And I'm going to assume you're going to do that. Okay? This actually came from the front. Now, one other thing that you can do environmentally is you could have taken, they have some other candles that are back there. I wouldn't use the same one because the Paschal candle should ideally be different than the other candles, but you might have been able to find another candle to put it next to the ambo. Because the word is important, and so the ambo where the word is proclaimed should be could be highlighted a little more. Maybe with light would really be nice. Okay? All right, Larry.
More narration. As in funerals, there will be non-Catholic. So a little more narration from Frank or somebody to direct, to let the non-Catholics know a little bit.
Who's the non-Catholic? I was doing it for this community.
Well, some of their family and friends?
No, I knew the community. I know my chief.
I know my chief.
English. Some of you are Jewish. You can determine who your assembly is, but you have to let people know. He took you exactly the way you were and then presented it as such.
No, and I just considered who I was when I was doing that, mm-hmm. the worship day, like how much you know, and I figured you just know everything I know. So
that's one way to do it. Okay? Both points are well taken. Yes.
I don't know, I guess it's the layout, but I would have prepared during the blessing of the mother and father and lighting of the candle that I can see them all the nuns behind the altar, but like the whole thing, like the baptism. But again, it's the layout because I don't think we have enough space. We could have done it over there. We're in, the candles and the blessing of the father and the mother.
You didn't feel like you could see them well enough from where you were?
I think that the altar.
The candle we did over here.
Yeah, but then what after that, after the altar.
Okay, let's talk about this for a minute because these are important questions. And the thing that's important is what's the goal? What is it that we want most to express and for people to experience at the time that she's talking about, which is when he blesses the parents?
They should feel the power of the parents.
Okay.
They should feel like they're not standing there alone, but
that's right. So he's finished to making the connection with the altar, with the Our Father, right? So then all he has to do is recess back down and stand here. And, you know, the family can be standing here facing all of you. And you are all here. And we can all raise our hands in blessing, too. I want to tell you that last year, the blessings that that we did last year, I thought were all too long. Everybody was blessing everybody, and it was too much. I thought what Frank did was just perfect. They added some things that didn't work out. So I think what you drew out of the book really does work okay here, all right? Now you could actually ask the people to hold their hand up and adjust your blessing with you if you want. You could do that if you wanted to. But I wouldn't go beyond that, because it can get to be too much, okay? So thank you for that, and thank you for that, because that's the question. That's what you say to yourself. You know, not because I like it better, but okay, what are we trying to do here, and what's the connection? And you've already made this powerful statement about the altar. Now move away. In some ways, it mitigates that if you stay there too long. Okay? Jesse?
Also something about, I don't know, there was a movement from this place, this area over here, kind of back and forth. Was, I don't know, to me was distracting.
I think probably what you're talking about is that there were some times when the movement of Mike and Martha, this isn't blaming anybody for anything, but there were times when it was clear they didn't quite know what to do. It's one of the reasons why you really need an assistant, and somebody who you work with regularly, whether it's your wife or an altar server in the parish or whatever, or your MC at the parish or whatever, so that that person, when you're trying to do what you're doing, which is presiding, that person can kind of be a little more directional so that people know where they're supposed to go, and then those things will not be as obvious. They're still going to happen, because people forget, they're nervous, and everything. The presider's not the only one that's nervous.
We're
the
like parents and everybody is nervous too. For some reason.
Yeah. And you want to make sure that the ritual that you have, I mean, it's appropriate, probably would be more appropriate for the lighting of the candle to be over here, rather than to have, I think the way they did it is they were over there, and somebody came over here and they went back. Yeah. I'm not against processions. But I think of it about the way candles normally are next to a font. The reason why Frank chose to put it over here is not ideal, but it made sense because of the space that we had here. We want people to be able to move around it. But by having it over here, the compromise you make is it's not as connected. I can't lift it up. But if it were standing right next to the font, if there's any way that you could do that and still leave room for the ritual, then do it.
I originally had it in here, and I tripped over it while I was
sitting. See, he practiced, so he knew what was going to work and what wasn't going to work. But normally, this should be connected with this.
Now, weren't you saying that it should be closer, preferably closer to the handle?
No, another one.
No,
the handle. Oh.
No, another one completely different.
Oh.
This actually is an altar candle. It's not a paschal candle. They don't have a paschal candle.
But that's supposed to be a paschal candle.
Yeah, but we're using it as a paschal candle. It's the most significant one they have. Mm-hmm. So that's why you can't use the other one for the ambo, because it would be the same, and then it's not a good symbol, because you know the ambo candles or altar candles are not the same as the paschal candle. Now what we could do, and I actually have something at home, maybe a bigger candle that we use.
You know, in my parish we got some old paschal candles down here fully used. There's just
could you bring that?
Yeah, I'll bring
then we'll just replace it.
Yeah.
And so then we can use the other one like this as a processional candle, or you know, a candle on the side. Okay, how about you, Diane?
Holding the baby, it occurred to me midway through that should I be holding the baby the whole time, or give her to her daddy, or maybe give her to the godparents? I don't know if there's any instruction on there in the right. Who holds the baby?
There is only one place where it says the mother should be holding the baby.
For the whole thing?
The whole time? No, it does not. It's only at the one time where it says it's specific, because there's options. You could either anybody, and they give you these cultural things. In some cultures, the godparents do that stuff, and some kind of fair.
I really like you to bring you on. Are you done with Rick and Maureen at this point?
No, we have one more class.
Talk to them about that, would you please? Yeah. And then come back with a concrete. They have a way they do it. I can't remember, so I don't want to represent it. But they have a way of involving everybody in a really a good way. Okay? So I would suggest that you ask them and then come back with that the next time so that we know.
Okay. The only thing I had was, did you remember saying grandparents and a godparent?
at one point.
No, yeah, you didn't notice it, but
yeah.
I thought they were grandparents, and I thought, I wonder who they are.
So he met godparents.
He met godparents. That was a good guy, but we're I was wondering if you realized it. Yeah. Yeah. We don't say godparents every day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I'm so happy with the baby. I'm ready for grandpa.
You really treat it like a real person.
The only thing, Frank, is smile more. And no, I mean, that's advice I got years ago, too, on something else. But because it makes, how can I put it, relaxes everybody, it makes it more, you know. I know it's, you got to, on the one hand, it's a solemn rite, but on the other hand, it's kind of a celebratory rite. So if you smile more, we'd feel happier.
You know what, if the daddy
can
smile more.
I didn't know that. I know if you smile more.
I know what Jesse meant, because I didn't know if I should go with Mike to light the candle, or should I stay where I was, or what position should I be, on the right side or the left side. I mean, we only talked about it, but we didn't really, you know that when we practiced, I was supposed to be on one side, and then we turned out to be on the other. So
that's why you need an MC.
A little confusion right there, because we didn't know, it was the first time, so you know, we had to work out a little bit of kinks, but I think all Nagi did a fabulous job.
Yeah.
And I think the godparents and the parents did a great job for being the
first one.
Because we had our roles up there as well,
At the beginning, when he started at the back of the church, should he say anything to the assembly? I mean, because he went right into the right.
Exactly.
I mean, greeted them, or thank you for all being here.
And would you feel comfortable doing that?
I should have said it before I even went back.
That's exactly right. So I want to
get on the way up. If you notice, I stopped. And I saw you back here doing my job.
Yeah. See, sometimes a cantor will do it, you know. And
what did you say?
And basically what I did was I welcomed everyone,
my family. You say turn off your cell
phone. No, I didn't do that. But actually, people should be told to do that. But, you know, basically you welcome people, you kind of let them know it's going to be happening. You say we're going to meet at the door of the church and why. And you can actually even invite people to go back there with you if you want. But what I did is I invited people to really sing because, you know, to welcome and to really create a sense that we're getting something new or whatever. So yes, it's always good to do that. It's good to introduce yourself, not to make too much of yourself, but you know, say, I'm Deacon Frank, and you're such a smart aleck. Okay, I think it's all pretty good, and I think yes, Jesse.
Question. Now, do we have to have the first reading and the psalm?
Have the second reading?
But we didn't have a second reading.
I mean, in the gospel. No, you do not have to. Jesse pointed out something that I didn't even realize because I'm so used to doing the liturgy of the word with, you know, a reading and then a psalm and then the gospel. So he pointed out that there isn't really a first reading mentioned there, but I know that it's presumed to be okay. Because again, it's certainly, you see it in the
It's an option. They're giving us an option.
Can you find where it says that? Because we couldn't find it. I wasn't looking real closely.
The passage is just in the maybe in the other passage.
Oh, they're on the very back. Okay, because we looked at the place earlier where we couldn't find it. So you can do an Old Testament, a New Testament, one or the other. Don't do two.
But I made a point of these readings when I was choosing readings. I remember you saying how you would like somebody to do a homily other than the gospel.
It was so beautiful.
Perfect.
Yeah, it was. And not only that, but when you choose a reading that's a little shorter, because you know you really basically have it in your memories. So the eye contact was just really good.
That's beautiful.
Okay? All right, yes.
As a deacon couple, what should we do, the wives?
You know what? I want you to work that out for yourselves. I just want you to keep in mind, I think, what I already said to you. And that is that there is no single way of doing it. That last year there were women who did everything from were the reader only, to women who were the server only, to women who only did the intercessions. to women who are only hospitality ministers and invite other people to do other things. You can do it however you want.
Rich and Maureen Soria do it as a couple.
Yeah, if you,
so if you really want to see what the potential is, ask them when the next baptism is and go to it. Well, we did that last summer.
They really are dynamic together.
Yes.
You should. I've never seen
it. Which church are really working with
you? Which church are
you saying? Mark and Mary.
All right, so we know the next one's going to be Ray and Remy. And then Frank is going to be the teacher. And then whoever comes after that will be taught by the two of you. Okay?
I'm sorry. Michael should help tear down.
Yes, you can have this with me.
Oh, yeah.
Just tell me where
it is. That's great. Okay.
Where did it?
You know what? Let's go ahead and just do this now.
Empty Frank.
To the room.
You bring this one?
This one. This one I got inside there.
I know.
Okay.
This what? Goes,
that
goes separate from this, and there's tape also in the front here that needs to be removed.
Remy, that's not mine. Look at that.
Yeah, I think there's two on that
side. Where's the table go, Frank?
Huh?
Well, my son
got that cloth.
This is for the gifts in the center of the aisle. The white cloth stays on it. Oh, that white cloth stays on that table.
Oh, Frank.
Hey, this stays on here.